In the 1700s, Edmund Burke wrote the book, A Philosophical Enquiry into the Sublime and Beautiful. And he makes an argument that I was studying today that I've literally never heard before. And that is that beauty is not necessarily symmetrical with symmetry. Ibid, right? It, as tautological as that may sound, as recursive as that might be, like beauty and symmetry are not always inextricably intertwined. In fact, he talks about how a painter could paint a perfectly symmetrical person and make it quite ugly. But he also talked about how he could create a painting of somebody who wasn't so symmetrical, who was more asymmetrical and yet had great beauty. Because we think of deformity as the antipode of beauty, and that which is proportionate and that which is balanced as associated with beauty. When in fact he says, actually, that's not always true. We associate beauty less with what is proportionate and more with what is novel. So it's not like, oh, how well proportioned is this person in balance and symmetry? It's how much novelty does this strike me with? And that's where we associate certain degrees of beauty. So he talks about how deformity is actually not the antipode of beauty, and symmetry is not always beautiful. Isn't that interesting? Now, here's where it gets even crazier. He talks about this not only in the human world, but like in architecture. Like, we think of architecture in perfect symmetry, but actually the most beautiful buildings more strike us with their novelty. So the more they can, architects create, and again, he's writing in the 1700s, like a T-shaped person type of building, that has more novelty and will strike us more visually as aesthetically pleasing in some cases. So he also talks about the animal kingdom. Like, if you look at a swan, right, this is considered one of the most beautiful birds. It is not proportionate. Look at how much longer its neck is in proportion to the rest of its body. In fact, it has a vastly long neck in comparison to the rest of its body proportionally, but it has a really small tail. And yet we consider the swan beautiful. You say, oh, well, maybe that's the formula for beauty. It's like a long neck and a short tail in the animal kingdom. Well, no, let's go over to the inversion and look at a peacock. It's the exact opposite. It has a short neck and a long tail. I've seen a peacock in person. They are beautiful, beautiful creatures, and they seem to know it, right? Peacocking around, they seem to know it. But you look at a swan that has a long neck and a short tail, but a peacock has a long tail and a short neck. So it's the exact opposite. And yet we consider the peacock very beautiful. And the point that he's making is that beauty is not always found, as he's talking about the origin of beauty, which is part of value theory in the philosophical pyramid. Like, beauty is not always symmetrical. And this is what I want to tell you in your life. Now, this is where I'm going to take it to an abstract place and put my own spin on it. I think that can also be said of the events of our lives. That so often we think, if things make sense, if they're nice, neat, right angles, if they're square, if they're perfectly proportionate, if everything is well balanced and I have everything in order, that means my life is beautiful. But actually, isn't it a bit of the touch of chaos that creates some of the greatest aesthetically pleasing, in the philosophical sense, the most aesthetically pleasing events in your life? It's when it might have started out chaotically. That's why if you have OCD, it's encouraged that you go to the forest or out in nature, because things are not proportionate. And yet, even though things are not proportionate, we consider them very beautiful. In fact, Burke actually uses the example of an orange tree. An orange tree is not symmetrical, but we consider it very beautiful. And so the point is like, if your life, this is where I want to take it, doesn't seem symmetrical, doesn't seem proportionate, doesn't seem well balanced, could it be that the beautiful is actually going to be created from the abnormality? That the deformity is not the antipode of beauty, but rather it is complementary to it? That'll give you a whole new perspective and a brand new look, pun intended, when it comes to viewing and having a POV of your sufferings.